Welcome to Vital Mississippi. We're going to talk about present, past, and future. Welcome to the show.
Hey, good job, Kai. Good job. Kai. Welcome everybody to the show. We're going to have a great show lined up for you, ladies and gentlemen. We got a wonderful student here who has some artwork to show. We're going to talk about the airport, talk about several issues in relation to Jackson. We're going to answer a few questions and make sure that everybody understands my position on these lease chases and some things going on with the city of Clinton. But first and foremost, we have a young lady on the show, Mac.
Okay.
Who, her name is Miss Alexandria Horn. Okay. Now, I was at, where were we, Karen, a couple weeks ago?
We were at
Capital City Alternative School. They had a program there, and this young lady showed me her artwork. Mm. And I said, we got to really invest in children, highlight what they're doing. Welcome to the show, Ms. Horn.
Thank you.
So, you got your artwork. Tell the people a little bit about yourself and about your aspirations to be an artist.
Well, I'm 16 years old. I attend Clinton High. I started drawing when I was in the sixth grade.
Mm-hmm.
My art teacher inspired me that I can express myself by drawing. So I was like, well, since I like to express myself, I think I'm just going to continue drawing and doing things like that.
Well, one thing I do know, our young folks' creativity is important. And that's why I wanted to give you a little space to talk about your drawing. Show us what you got there. But she said she's gonna draw a picture of me.
I said, I want to see that.
Go on the internet and find a picture.
Okay, so here's some of the drawings that I drew.
Pass them down. I'm gonna show them to our folks on Facebook.
And if you're on Facebook, you definitely can tune in. This is some beautiful artwork that she has. Oh man, you got a lot of artwork here. So, what are some of the things that you try to that you like to draw in your when you're drawing?
I usually like to draw like either cartoon characters, famous people. I sometimes get requests to draw people from my school, and I just draw them and I give it to them.
So, as a budding artist, so we need to find you an opportunity to display your artwork so people can see it, right? We need to get you some time on the public access channel.
Mm.
So you can display your artwork and let people know your talents.
I think here's like.
Now you gonna draw a picture of me, right? Let me see.
I am. I was gonna come last.
I was gonna come last. Okay. So, ladies and gentlemen, I wanted to talk about a little art today because we have to look out into the community and identify children who have talents, and then give them a space to display their talent. I'm asking for any pastors who would like to have a talent show at your church. You know, give us a call. And we can, you know, help facilitate it and broadcast. We don't like to put on all these events ourselves, but we like to partner with folks. So if you would like to create some spaces and places for our children to have a little competition every couple of months so they can build up and display their talents, because our children are our most valuable assets, and they got talents other than, you know, schoolwork is important, but the music and the arts and all those things give them the freedom to be creative and share with the world. So if you have an inkling to want to do something in the community, and you want to host a talent show so we can showcase our children, please give us a call and let us know. Our office number is 601-960-2052. That's 601-960-2052. So, Alexander, so tell us about some of your goals for the future. What do you want to do when you grow up?
Well, when I grow up, I plan on going to college in Texas because I want to be a pediatrician.
A pediatrician? So what made you choose Texas?
Because they have like, well, when I was doing my research, I found out that they had the best medical college up there.
Really?
So I want to go up there and do study to be a pediatrician.
Now, we got a lot of young folks in this state who need better health care. So I tell everybody, go see the world. But when it's time for you to come on back, and you want to have a family and all that stuff, come on back to Mississippi. So you go out, Mama, you don't mind she come back, baby.
Oh, she can come back, but without the family.
Oh, come back and start it then, right?
No, she has been in her practice for a couple of years.
Leave the family out. Just come back.
Well, you know, once you go out and see the world and get some experience from other things, you know, bring your talents and skills back home to Mississippi because we sure need it. So let me see this artwork that you got for me.
I want to see this picture of Calvin Stanton.
Oh, man. Nah, who is the picture right there?
Well, see, that picture was in the background, so I said, well, y'all want it to look too plain, so I went on and tried to draw the background, too, so.
Now, do you know, in my office, I got a picture of Malcolm X and Martin Luther King with the same pose. See, that's divine intervention there. That's a beautiful picture. Well, I sure appreciate you, dear, for coming.
Thank you.
So, just so the folks will know.
Is that Councilman's dance?
So, just so the folks will know, tell folks a little bit about yourself one more time, and then if they want to get a picture drawn of themselves, and you taking orders, right? Because remember, in the talk I gave at the school, I said you got to be able to monetize your gifts, right? Mm-hmm. So if somebody wants a self-portrait done, can they call your mama and take the order done? I know I put my order in immediately.
Got a Facebook message, email, Bible. But you give them an email address.
Give them
an
email address.
Email address.
Or something like that. They can contact.
Okay, well, my name is Alexandria Horn. If you would like a requested picture, you can contact me at hornalexandria@gmail.com. It's hornalexandria@gmail.com.
Okay, so send her a message and support our young folks, because this is a young lady who's starting her career in art and creative drawing, and hopefully we can build her business up so that she can be an independent person who can, you know, come on and share her gifts to the rest of the world. So thanks a lot for coming, dear, and I appreciate you. All right, you have a good day. All right, and you go to Clinton High School, right?
I do.
That's right. Some people. Yeah, some people said that I had a problem with Clinton. I support folks in Clinton.
Support everybody.
I support everybody. As long as they're doing what they're supposed to do. But thanks a lot, dear.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. All right, come on, Mr. Fogg. Welcome to the show, Mr. D'Ray Fogg.
Hey, what's going on?
D'Ray, his name was meant to be a DJ, host, something. D'Ray Fogg.
You know what? You're not the first person to tell me
D. Fogg is his name.
Some lady told me, you need to be in Hollywood with that name.
D-Ray. They can't change their name from Ebenezer to D-Ray. Be cool.
Hey, man, everybody can't have it, though.
Hey, man.
Well, you know, Mr. Fogg, I really appreciate you for chiming on in. The program we were at over at Capital City Alternative School was a great event. We were there Saturday for last. Helping talk to the young folks about, and also listening. That's one of the things that us adults, we don't do enough of, is listening to the young folks. And they got some amazing things. We had a bunch of young folks on the show last week.
Right.
And they'll be coming back at the end of the month, or the end of next month, to discuss things as well.
I think that's a good thing that you're doing, is giving the young people a chance to express themselves and show their talents and show their concerns, and even about their own well-being, because perception is reality. So, you know, we need to listen to what they're talking about. Mm-hmm. One of the problems we see now is adults are not listening. Mm-hmm. So we can't solve their problems if we don't know what their problems are. So I think this is a great way to give them an opportunity to speak to the masses, let them know that, you know, these children, teenagers, have feelings and perceptions too, and we need to listen to them and bear them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Especially when they take you know, they take a lot of the art programs, the extracurricular programs out of a lot of schools now, and it doesn't really give them a platform to be able to voice their opinions or even just give them an outlet to learn what their true voice is.
Right, expression.
Right. As we, you know, things are being taken out of our schools, we get to keep them in our homes.
Right.
You know, just because prayer is not in school, we got to get the prayer in the home.
Right.
If the art's not in the school, get the art in the home. If the music's not in the school, get the music in the home. Mm-hmm. And give the children a space to be creative. In the space to touch their divinity.
Right.
Because that's that true power.
Right.
You know, God is a creator. We were made in the image of God, so we create.
Right.
Right? Mm-hmm. Right. So you can't block that. Right.
That's true.
So we got a lot of touching issues this week, Matt. We've been in the news a couple times. You know, we've been.
Yeah.
You know, I got some threats this week.
Really?
In a while.
Right. You were due for one of them.
Right. I'm past due for some threats. Thank y'all for coming in.
Thank you.
And we got a couple threats going on.
It's ironic that you got threats now when you hear on domestic soil.
Right.
But everybody was supporting you when you risked your life for their freedom of speech, and they turn around and threaten you. So it's a little ironic.
I got a right to say what I got to say.
Right. You know, when you take that right, well, you know, it's ironic.
Let me just educate the folks. We've been, this is really probably the last time I'm educate on this situation.
Right.
Last week I made some comments, last Thursday I believe it was, referencing the city of Clinton to Ferguson.
Right.
Let me tell you why. I'm not a unintelligent person. I make things, you know, after doing research, the research said that the city of Clinton is a 42% minority city.
Mm, right.
It has zero minority political representation.
Right.
Okay. That right there is a parallel to what happened in Ferguson.
Right.
High minority population.
Right.
Zero minority political representation.
Correct.
So I don't mind taking some bumps and bruises to highlight the fact that folks should have some political representation. I'm not going to apologize for that.
Right.
There will be no apologies. I will explain it, you know, so you can understand where I'm coming from. But there will be no apologizing for anything. You know, somebody called me and said responded by their press conference on Sunday and said, you know, you needed to apologize. And it wasn't, I'm not apologizing. Wait,
for what though?
Why is it so hard for it to be empathetic and apologetic for a loss of a life, but you should apologize for your comments?
Let me give some real numbers here. There are 11,200 minorities living in Clinton.
Right.
11,000. Zero political representation.
You can't find one.
Right. Okay, police department, high, it doesn't have a lot of brothers working, sisters working in the police force. All I'm saying is there needs to be some balance there. Another parallel to the city of Ferguson.
Right. And you champion on the issues, and as we highlighted Flint related to Jackson, mm-hmm. you're highlighting a city that's already been through that, mm-hmm. and what we're looking at trying to do is preventative measures.
Right.
You know, and we did our homework. You know, this is not the first time we had this conversation 2 years ago when we were doing community forums about educating people and strengthening the relationship between law enforcement and community. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we definitely got to look at that, you know, and talk about this issues and how we prevent it from happening and fix the problem, you know. But people get in their feelings
and
make comments, but, you know, how are we going to help fix the problem?
You know, and for those who are listening, this is, as we get into this topic in this conversation, you want to put your thick skin on, because we are at war, mm-hmm. okay? And we have to understand that we have to play from a war position. We have to roll our sleeves up and be willing to take some bumps and bruises. Mm-hmm. Nobody, when we travel down this road, nobody said it was going to be easy or everybody would agree with you.
All right.
When you're championing for change, positive change, it's not going to be easy. Some people love the status quo. I had one caller call me and said, "You around here stirring up the good Negroes in Clinton." I said, "What?" He said, "They like it here. Leave them alone." I said, "What is this, 1840?
Right.
Do you own them? Do they have free papers?"
Right.
I mean, I was set back. If I let folks listen to my voicemail, you would be amazed at some of the positions
nothing,
that some people took.
Nothing right. shocks me. Sad to say.
When this brother called me and said,
"Nothing shocks me.
You stirring up the good Negroes of Clinton, leave them alone. They like the life we provide for them."
Right.
From a position of ownership.
And that's offensive on so many levels.
and to touch on the basis of understanding, I cannot stand a thief. Mm-hmm. You know? Period. So, right. Stealing is wrong.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, how, for what form of fashion? Stealing is wrong.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, we want law enforcement to do their job and protecting and serve and helping people.
Right.
I'm saying this today. Look, I think it was an act of disrespect towards the brothers and sisters in JPD, mm-hmm. but not even just, you know, reaching out to them. You know what I'm saying? Like, right. you know, not saying not apprehend the suspect or prevent them from doing something to somebody else,
mm-hmm.
but did you even follow protocol and reach out to the adjoining municipality?
Hello, caller. Welcome to the show.
Hey, hello, councilman, and your good man that hosts that one show with you. How y'all doing?
Hey, brother.
All right. How you doing?
I called for two reasons. One is to commend you and the gallant effort you have taken, step you have taken as it relates to supporting those individuals which you represent, which is part of your district as it relates to your ward. And I appreciate the fact of you joining with Councilman Stokes and opposing to those ruthless, as Councilman Stokes calls them, people that do not respect black law enforcement. That goes back long before you and I even came into existence. And that it is a giant disrespect for black law enforcement in Hinds County and Jackson as it relates to the other municipalities, which in turn, they do not respect the citizens as well. And the other thing I wanted to mention along the lines of the airport, there are people that proclaiming that they want to get involved with the issue and find out more about the issue. I want to suggest to all your listeners in the general public as well, Councilman, if they want to get involved, go out to the airport, call the airport. They have plenty of hours they wish to have volunteers. They could call 939-5631, extension 531, 939-5631, and ask for Ms. LaShire Dean, Ms. Dean, at that extension. Anybody can volunteer. And we all need to get involved with the airport so that we can maintain a good understanding about it. Thank you, Council.
Thank you, brother. You know, and what's also getting highlighted, overshadowed in this conversation, is that a young man lost his life.
Right. He just did nothing.
It's an incident. Now, the cause of it, first and foremost, was the thief.
Right.
I hold the thief accountable for all of it. The nexus of it all is the thief. First, he stole something.
And you hit
somebody. Then, he, the one, is led the chase.
Right.
Right. Mm-hmm. But the professionals, the trained professionals, should be of a higher standard. Let me give you an example. Off the coast of Africa a few years ago, some pirates took over a cruise ship. Mm-hmm. All right, I don't know if y'all remember off the coast of Somalia a few years ago. Some pirates took over. They made a movie out of it.
Right.
All right. So now they took over the ship. They called in the Marines. The Marines came in, a bunch of 19, 20, 21-year-old Marines, well-trained, right, came up on a boat. Boarded the ship, searched the whole ship, subdued all of the captives, no hostages were killed, and they didn't even fire a shot. High-level training can do this. I've seen it, and I've been a part of what higher-level training can do in the execution of law enforcement and military tactics.
Right.
So what all I'm saying is, the professionals need to rise above. Anytime there's a civilian that dies, that's a problem. In the military, when you're at war, when a civilian dies, that's a problem. Somebody got to be accountable for that.
Right.
Because the enemy, or the criminal in this case, is the nexus of it all.
Right.
So if anybody, the criminal should be dying first. Second, the people who have sworn their life in protection of the civilians.
Right.
Have made that commitment. When the civilians die, that's a problem.
Right.
The civilians didn't make a pledge for the risking of their life. They paid their taxes, and they look for other people to do that. The civilians are not supposed to be dying.
Right.
The professionals must rise above, look for the greater good in the best way to execute law enforcement and government and keep the civilians safe.
I know a lot. I just felt like the chase was, it was just very reckless, you know. I can't remember all of the streets that they hit on.
Oh, I got them for you, brother.
Oh, you have them for me.
People ask me, why am I speaking out on the issue? It's because they came through Ward 4. Let me give you the streets.
Okay.
Highway 80, South Drive, over West Haven, Robinson Road, Dixon Road, Wainwright, Williams, Galvez, Swanee, Redwood, Mount Vernon, Thomas Ketchins, Alabama, back to Capitol Street, to Denver Street, Claiborne Avenue, Lattimore, Houston, back to Capitol Street. That was one, it was two different chases happening. One route was one way, another car was coming behind, and the other car went through Glen Boulevard, over the Capitol, down Roslyn, Veterans Avenue. I mean,
that's over 20 streets, like, you know, so.
It's in the wee hours of the morning.
Right.
Five police cars from the city of Clinton. The people of Clinton should be in an uproar because the majority of their own legal officers left the city for a shoplift.
Exactly. Something that Walmart already has a loss prevention for, so, you know.
Let's catch this caller, bro. Okay. Hello, caller. Welcome to the show.
Good evening to all of you gentlemen there today, and I would like to make a comment
Go ahead,
about the situation in Clinton. Well, the caller that you said that the good Negroes need to stay in their places that they love Clinton and stop messing with the rest, that's not true. There are a lot of us who are very intelligent here in Clinton that do not tolerate foolishness from Clinton PD and no one else. Now, that caller that made that comment and talked to you, Brother Stanton, said that real good Negroes need to change his mind because when we get down to it, it's going to be a problem. It needs to be a problem.
Hey, I sure appreciate you for calling, brother.
All right, thank you.
Mm-hmm. And that goes to show that there's people in Clinton mm-hmm. who don't agree with the activity and feel that it does not represent them.
Right.
I think it would be more outraged. More outraged if they hit a dog. I'm just being truthful. Cause I've seen more compassion for an animal
right.
than it mm-hmm. is for a person that wasn't even doing anything. Mm-hmm. You know, it's been countless times that people have ran over somebody mm-hmm. several times before anybody stopped. I can't get over the humanitarian part of a life was lost. And nobody is really just giving any concern to the family, trying to support the family, and even saying that, you know, they had to do their duty to apprehend the suspect. We are deeply saddened and apologetic for the loss of life.
Right.
Nothing. It was my duty. And that's okay.
And then come back and say, we're going to do it again.
That's okay. But yeah, I can't understand it.
Right.
So, you know, this is not a guy, and don't nobody try to look on Facebook to find a way to paint it, to make him to be a criminal. Mm-hmm. This is a guy that's an innocent bystander that got hit. Mm-hmm. And we are not even giving acknowledgement to his family or even giving some support.
Let me chime in here. You can go to my Facebook page. There is a link to the GoFundMe account to help pay for the expenses for the funeral of Mr. Blue. I challenge all leaders, all Jackson leaders, the mayor, city councilman, the mayor of Clinton, the mayor and all the aldermen in Clinton, to go chime in. I made my contribution. It shouldn't take this long to raise enough money for a funeral.
So you got to do this. Any men of Phi Beta Sigma Fraternity Incorporated out there or any other fraternity, call in GoFundMe, Mac Epps is starting off contributing with $10 to get a brother stamps. Can we get 100 brothers to pledge $10?
I put my $100 in already.
Well, I don't have $100. Right. I'm starting my team.
Right.
Okay.
So everybody, you know, helped his family out because I'm not the type of person that goes and you know, runs up behind the family, because I know if it was me, I wouldn't want you
right.
to come and talk to me if my sister was that.
Right. You gotta call Councilman.
Hello, caller, welcome to the show.
How's everybody doing? This is Sylvia.
Hey, Sylvia.
I just had to call and say something about this. That family of Mr. Blue, they should not have to pay out a penny mm-hmm. because it wasn't Mr. Blue's fault. He had just got off of work and trying to get home. So by right, his family shouldn't have to pay a penny.
That's right.
The police department and the guy that hit Mr. Blue should be responsible for it. Now, that's just my personal opinion, because it really put a strain and a heartache and grief on the Blue family. And I'm just, you know, you just really get sick and tired of it, you know?
That's right. Thanks a lot, sir.
This man, life matters. His family matters. So they need to step up to the plate and be a man or women or whatever and pay for this man's funeral. Peace out, brother.
Thank you. Hello, caller. Welcome to the show. Hello, you on the air, caller.
Yeah, just to piggyback on what Kenneth Stokes said. Kenneth said the truest thing about the situation. The Clinton Police Department should be held accountable for this man's life, because they took his life. Because it was a misdemeanor. Walmart has
security camera
money to pay for
insurance.
The whatever. They can't bring this man's life back.
Right.
They write it off. Insurance board.
That's right. Thanks. Thank you, brother. So, first and foremost, I'm holding accountable the criminal.
Mm. Right.
Right? First and foremost.
His
right.
first mistake, he should have never stolen anything.
And if you are a criminal out there, you steal something, you see those blue lights, you need to stop.
Right.
right? Off the top. You see blue lights, you got a hot laptop in your car, they coming for you.
You know you've done wrong. Pull over. Go on and do what you
Because you're risking other people's lives.
Right. Right. Not just yours.
Not just yours.
Right.
But also you're making it worse. This brother went from a shoplifting charge.
Now
a murder charge.
Right. Right.
Rehabilitation, he could have been out on the straight and narrow.
Right. He could have, you know, served his distance to society on the shoplifting charge and moved forward. But now he got a murder rap.
Right.
Now his family is torn apart.
Two lives gone.
Right.
Two lives gone.
He's done.
Right.
He's done. He's gone.
And I got no sympathy for him.
Exactly.
I got none. I got no sympathy for him. Whatever they give him, he deserves it.
Right.
You got him in the call.
Hello, caller. Welcome to the show.
Hey, how you doing, Captain?
Hey, brother.
Hey, you remember the teenager y'all had on this last Wednesday?
Yes, sir.
Is this any kind of way that we can take up a donation to for a program for the youth to have a program on WMPI?
Mm-hmm.
And where I think it'll get better acquainted to more youth that will listen and maybe, you know, try to help solve some of this problem we got here in Jackson.
Well, I got your number down, brother. We're working on that as we speak. We opened up some time for them at the last show of the month of April. They'll be back, and we're working on having some space on the radio so young people can come display their talents.
Nick, I'd be glad. I'd love to do a donation. You know, help pay for the. You know, I know they're free.
Yes, sir. So what I'll do is I got your number down. This number that you're calling from, I can call you back on this number.
Yeah.
Okay, well, thanks a lot, sir, and I really appreciate you for calling.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Our community, our responsibility.
That's right, our community, our responsibility. Well, yeah. Hello, caller, welcome to the show.
How you doing, Brother DeKeither, number 5?
Do it that, brother. What's going on?
Okay, we done met before. You know, I'm on the lane as you are. Yeah. But now, let me tell you something. This is me just prophesying. The black community has lost a lot of credibility. But now, you wait until someone kills someone from the lesbian and gay community, and these folks are going to be out there in mire, complaining about what is going on, and then things are going to be done. Because the lesbian and gay community, I don't have a problem with those folks if they want to live their life. But it seems as though they are more organized now than the black community, and even the white community is, because white folks are getting killed and black folks too. But when one member of the gay community is killed and something happens like that, you just watch and see what the uprising and outcry will be. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, brother. Hello, caller. Welcome to the show.
Yes. Hey, to change the subject, I'm trying to get an update on abandoned houses the city of Jackson wanted to sell to the neighborhood residents.
Okay.
Who do I need to contact?
Okay, you can contact the planning department in the city of Jackson in the surplus property division. It's across the street from City Hall. And you go sign up and fill your application out for the property. It's like I said, it's right across the street from City Hall in the hood building.
Yeah, in the hood building.
Yep.
In the what building?
In the hood building. HOOD building. Hood building.
Oh, the hood building.
Yes, sir.
Oh, okay. Do you have a number, sir?
We'll look it up and call it on the show. Can you look up the planning department number? Yes. But we'll call it on the show once we look it up. Okay, brother?
Okay, thanks.
Right. And that program you're talking about is a Neighbors First program where you can purchase property in your neighborhood if the city owns it. For, what is it, $50 if it's a vacant lot, and $100, you know, so.
I think it's up to $250, I think, okay. Something like that.
Speaking of Neighbors First, can we get back to getting some donations for this family? We didn't.
Right, let's go back to the family.
Can we get some calls to call in and pledge some donations to support the family?
Did what they were supposed to do. They raised the
law. Well, there's a caller right now. They're going to donate some money. I feel it on their heart.
Hello, caller. Turn your radio down, bro.
All right.
What's your question or comment?
I agree with y'all on everything.
Okay.
They was definitely wrong for pursuing that chase. And the reason I say that, yesterday, I was at Food Depot on Northside Drive.
Mm-hmm.
Man had about maybe $75, $80 off the grocery goods and just rode straight on out the door. They changed it to folks in the door. But they didn't get in no car and do no high-speed chase.
resources back.
It's a way to do it in a safe way for all citizens.
Well, it's out there. I don't know why we do it. We're able to work, and this is a young person. Able to work. It's just jobs that they don't want to do. And it shouldn't be that way. You got a family, you got to learn how to get out there and support them.
That's right.
You got to work on what you want. And taking is not the answer.
You're right, brother. I appreciate you for calling. Hello, caller. Welcome to the show.
Who would you have to read
the
donation
at? Okay, well, right now it's online is how you donate to it, but I can take your number down and I have somebody give you a call once we get off the air, okay?
Can you send to your PO box?
Okay, all right.
I'm going to take your number down, brother, and we'll call you after the show and talk to you, okay?
Okay, all right.
But you can go to our Facebook page if you're listening. And the link to the GoFundMe account is posted there, and leave a donation. You can use your debit card or credit card, stuff like that.
I want to commend that brother for calling in and not only giving comment, but also reaching out to help. That's what we see a problem. Mm-hmm. And that's my whole thing. My mentality is solution oriented. Whatever we see a problem, we ask, are we contributing to that problem? And what can I do to help? No mm-hmm. matter, you know, so we all can do something to help, regardless. Right. Donations of what?
Right.
Even taking them something to eat, or just anything, you know. Just
anything we can do as a whole, because we have to look at ourselves as a village.
Right.
And stop looking at ourselves as individuals. Mm-hmm. So,
also, we have to, if you want to bring a donation down to the radio station, you can leave it, and we can make sure that the family gets it as well. So you can bring it down to the radio station and see Miss Wanda Evers during working hours, and you can bring an envelope, and we'll make sure that it gets to the family. If you just want, if you don't have access to the internet or computer and stuff like that, you can just bring a donation down to the station. Okay. All right. So, remember, the family did what they were supposed to do. They raised a law-abiding, hard-working young man who believed in family and preparing to get married. What more can we ask for a family to do?
Right.
Right. So that's why we must execute government better. But also, the criminal is the first person that we're saying is responsible for this. Mm-hmm. And secondly, the practices exasperate situations by the professionals. Mm-hmm. The professionals have a debt to this problem too, because the professionals are supposed to rise above and be the professionals.
And handle it a whole lot better than the way they did.
Right. And the other part of it is the Central District of Mississippi should be the strongest district in this state. But we're allowing for our pain and oppressive habits of old to drag us into the gutter. Mm-hmm. We're allowing for our pain and hatred of the past, our Mississippi history, that oppressive culture of our history to hold us back. We're sitting here fighting over airports and police chases when we should be doing business all over the world. Mm-hmm. We should be in China and Japan and working together to build a region. Right? Mm-hmm. To be in the global marketplace. We shouldn't be a state known for hatred, oppression, somewhere where you can come wave your Confederate flag and walk down the street with an AK-47 in your hand. Mm-hmm. That's not what we should be.
Right.
We should be a place where people want to come to be tourists. We shouldn't be, you know, the last stronghold of the Confederacy. We should be a working together, because it's a global marketplace.
Right.
And we should be doing that, not trying to take the local region's assets from each other.
We're still trying to figure out how to live.
We're still fighting the Civil War, for goodness
sake. Right. And that's like, and that's true. We in a different place. You know, I've sit on this committee talking about ending race within our lifetime. Mm-hmm. And I had to express it to all my brothers and sisters in the Pacific and all across the world that, you know, we're still fighting the black and white fight.
Right. Mm-hmm.
You know, we haven't even made it to recognizing other things, and that's what we talk about, because people don't want to come. My wife's grandmother did not come to our wedding because she said she don't travel over the Mason-Dixon line. Because she see from watching the news and alerts, she didn't come. Right. She sent support and that was it. So we are scaring more people out because they're looking at, if we fight each other like this, mm-hmm. what are we going to do to a stranger,
right.
a Yankee? Mm-hmm. You know, I'm just going to put it out there and say it like it is. What are we going to do to them? That's how people looking at us in this state. And we are the most progressive city, Jackson.
Mm-hmm.
And look what we're doing. Come on.
Yeah. You know, somebody asked me, folks asked me to support all different kinds of movements and causes, right? And about 2 years ago when the gay marriage conversation was kicking up, and they said, you're going to support gay marriage. I said, we're in Mississippi. There's some place in Mississippi where a white person and a black person can't get married yet.
Right.
Right.
Oh, they could.
Right, in Crystal Springs, where my mom was from.
Member of the church couldn't get married.
They couldn't, a black person and a white person couldn't even get married. Right. So we ain't even to that.
We ain't made it that far.
Right.
You got to call counsel.
So the case is called. Hello, caller. Welcome to the show.
Again, simple price.
Do it that, brother.
Could someone explain to me about this GoFundMe page? You know, I understand folks need help.
Mm-hmm.
But now, if there's a certain amount of money needed to bury an individual or to conduct funeral services, if there's money collected over that, does the family get to keep it or what? Now, I'm computer illiterate, and I admit that. So my donation will have to go through the Rick and Mortar Foundation because I can't do that. I don't have that type of technology.
Okay, so, yes, sir. Anything over and above, the family gets to keep it.
But if I just want to know, you know, for those of us who don't know about that, you know, if the funeral costs this, $5,000
and
GoFundMe collects $30,000. The family gets to keep all of that, and I'm out.
Yes, sir. And the way those GoFundMe pages work is, you know, you can raise money for different causes, and the family gets to keep whatever they raise minus a transaction fee. And so it's up to the family how they spend it. And, you know, it's just a small token. You know, the little money we raise, it cannot replace a son or a brother or a dad or a fiance.
Right.
You know, so, and if you don't, can't do, if you're not computer literate, come on, drop by the radio station. Hello, caller. Welcome to the show. Hello, you're on the air, caller. Okay.
Okay. The phone was stuck.
I know, right? Hello, caller. You're on the air.
We done broke it.
Okay, we done broke the phone.
Oh, no. All
right, so, again, we got to work together as a central district and provide better government. So I answered that. And provide better government. And I'm not saying Jackson don't have problems.
Right.
Jackson has plenty of problems.
Mm-hmm.
Plenty of ways to get better. So we're going to have to continue to work towards getting better and being a better government.
Exactly.
The next issue we're going to talk about as we shift gears, same oppression, different topic, is on this airport deal.
How do you feel bad, man?
What?
I just knew one of my fraternity brothers gonna call in with some donation money.
Right. Well, don't worry, we'll get on.
Don't count them out.
Okay. Maybe they gonna call in.
I was at a press conference today, protesting against the airport. We've been to the Capitol over and over again.
Right.
On this issue, every time, you know, they have proven to us, and that's why I want folks to get their thick skin off, because it's gonna get a little hard conversation here.
Oh Lord.
They've proven to us the position that they're playing from and how the table will be set from this legislature for the next 4 years.
Mm-hmm.
So our response is going to be based on the way the rules have been set,
mm-hmm.
and the actions that people have played. They've told us that they're not going to, it's hard to do good business with folks who don't have honesty and integrity.
Right.
You know, our leadership was told that the airport bill was going to not make it out of committee. Told that by the Speaker of the House. It made it out of committee. The Speaker of the House also was the one that said, come out to the flag, should come down. Remember that? And he allowed for no flag bills to come out of committee. See, it's hard to do business if you're not being honest.
Right.
I've been dealing with people who don't like me, who hate me, who want to kill me, who don't like black folks, who want to send us back to whatever age. You know, I've been dealing with those folks my whole life, right? The military is full of them, but it was one way we'd always be able to do business. and get an understanding. Integrity. With integrity, we've always been able to look each other in the eye and say, you know what, I'm going to do what I say I'm going to do. You do what you say you're going to do. We can get back to hating each other later.
Right. Unified front.
Right now, business.
But right now, this is business.
Yeah.
And it's hard to do business if you cannot leave the table, look a man in the eye, shake his hand, mm-hmm. and say, this is what the deal is going to be. It's hard to do business like that. Hello, caller. Welcome to the show. Turn your radio down, caller.
Yeah, hello.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I think we really need to start in removing ourselves away from this system to become, you know, more community-based, because it's not going to work for us, like, trying to, as I see it, begging to even come in the house and have a seat at the white man's table. It's not going to happen. We need to draw back from out that system and build out with hope, truth, and faith, because our people ain't got no faith, period. You know, trying to rely on a system that is engineered to destroy us, keep us in poverty, keep us mentally destroyed, physically destroyed, separated. This system is engineered by demise, period. The only way we can defeat that is not spend money with this system. We can't keep on financing our own destruction. That's my point.
Right. Hey, I appreciate you, brother. And, you know, that's why we're about to launch a Jackson First campaign.
Mm-hmm.
Is, you know, as we push against outside forces, what we do with what we have in building our own economics and our own communities is the direction we're going in.
Right.
That's why also in that same press conference that folks got up in arms about is because I looked them in the eye and said, we must use our votes mm-hmm. and our money to execute change in the system.
Right.
And period.
That was the first thing I said. The first flag, rather, they had at the Capitol. I said, so when you tell them this and they don't do it, because they're not going to take it down, mm-hmm. what means are you willing to go?
Right.
You know, find out. If it means that much to you, then make the sacrifice. Right. Organize. Discipline yourself. Don't spend money. Spend your money where you know it's going to be appreciated. You know, that's the thing that we have to do, and I agree, you know, to the extent that we have to start making our vote, make them respect our vote, and make them respect our dollars.
That's right.
You know, you got to start with us.
That's right. And here at Reviving Mississippi, we're a different breed of Mississippian.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we're not the meek, mild breed.
Right.
I'm shy.
You are?
Yes.
We're going to have a talk.
Okay.
Mr. Fall.
Yes,
when
sir.
You came to be with us,
mm-hmm.
what was the first question I asked you, if you're going to hang out with us?
Mm-hmm.
Remember the first question I asked you? I know we talked a long time.
Yeah, about
and I asked you, are you willing to what?
Work.
No.
Am I willing to die?
D. And die.
I said, are you willing to die for what you believe in?
Yes, sir.
And then I said, what are you believing in? If you believe in truth, justice, fairness, mm-hmm. equality, then you can hang out with us. So we got a smaller group, but the commitment level is higher.
Right.
So just because you may talk about us in the media, that don't change my commitment level.
Exactly.
Our commitment is to the end. So, and we're committed to this pathway mm-hmm. all the way through. Hello, caller. Welcome to the show.
Hey, this is Clarence from Prince. You know, it seems to me that what we're failing to do. You know, just like this, the white folks are using the law. They go straight to the law, and they just like, for example, for our governor, they've already been trying to oust him out of office in accordance with the law because he's unconstitutional. And so that's what we got to do. But, you know, the way it looks to me is like in Mississippi, it is totally unlevel all the way around for black folks to succeed anyway. So to me, in accordance with the Constitution, I don't have all the information to be able to get all the pertaining to the Constitution like you guys might do, because I'm broke, busted, and disgusted.
No,
but the bottom line is, the Constitution states that if you do not have, if it's an unfair or an unlevel situation, you have the right to take it to a higher court other than the state level. You go all the way, you have to take it to Washington, D.C., stuff like that. Well, we know we're going to lose, because if you got five folks that eat onions, and you got three folks that don't eat onions, guess who's breath gonna be smelling like onions at the end of every meal? Everybody. Mm. You see? And so that's what we got here going on in Mississippi. you know, there's no way that we can go to a voting table or a voting ballot or a booth and vote and win. And so rather, so we can sit back and we can vote all day long. But until we understand and make it a census, then we got to take it further than Mississippi, because our legislature is not going to go for us, even though we're right about it.
You know, it can be
against the law. And so until we actually go and get the head out of office and get him to step down, because he's not going in court with the promotion and fostering of good wealth and good fortune in Mississippi and a good living space for Mississippians, until we go and let it be known up to the head of the United States of America that we can't live under conditions like that, then we're going to continuously be belittled, because right now we have given them an inch and they've taken a mile, because the bottom line is that we are allowing them to break the law. And then on top of that now, just like I heard these commissioners' wives or whatever got caught in the mall stealing or whatever, you've heard very little about that. But yet still, they can run way down in our neighborhoods and do a high-speed chase to go catch our folks. But now these commissioners' wives and all these legislators' wives, they get caught in belts and everywhere else stealing stuff. And very little said it. And so we just need to start being letting the right things be heard to the right people. Because we can scream, we can go to the cows to find our bull's tail looking for milk, and we're what we're going to get.
Yeah, I appreciate what I got to say about it. I appreciate it, brother.
That brother has some metaphors.
Yeah. Right? You know, but we're not going to just to only vote our way out of this.
Vote out.
It's the building of an economic, right, is the foundation. Because check us out. Aren't the Asians getting what they want? Aren't the Hispanics getting what they want?
Yeah.
They ain't even voting.
That's see, true.
It's the building of an economic base and the commitment to your community first.
They're building the foundation.
Right. They say, we can vote later. Let me build an economic and build a community.
Come on over, Jason.
Right? You know, so that's what our focus is going towards, the building of an economic and a community.
Right.
Then, you know, since we do have the right to vote, we're going to continue to vote.
Right.
But the building of an economic system and the building of the community concern, where it all matters, because black lives won't matter until they matter to us first.
Exactly.
In all ways, when black education matters, when black health matters, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And in that coupled society, like here in Jackson, where we have groups that must come together as a city, then we can move forward with black and white and everybody else who was in Jackson as a group. You had to vote your basic interest first. So now we're moving towards calling on all parts of Jackson to make a commitment to Jackson first.
Mm-hmm.
First and foremost, the first thing out of your mind when you're looking at doing anything, let me make sure that Jackson's involved. Whether it's fixing my house, okay, where you buy that lumber at, brother? Where them shingles come from? When you're talking to contractors about doing work at your house,
mm-hmm.
Make sure that came from Jackson.
There you go.
I want to see the supply receipts.
There you go.
You know, seriously. And that's what we're talking about. We're moving just the shop Jackson to demand that Jackson be put first.
Right.
So if we're spending a dime, I don't care if you're getting some toilets or whatever you're finna buy.
You got toilets at Lowe's. I like to take.
And right. If they don't have it in the store, they can order.
They can buy from
it. And they didn't price match.
Right.
So if somebody said, well, I can get it cheaper in Rankin County. Well, they all price match.
There you go, Cal.
Everybody price match.
And going back to what Jason just said about self-preservation.
Oh, okay. Oh. Yeah. Karen, keep me on point. The brother who called about the Neighbors First program, the telephone number to the planning department is 601-960-1154. That's 601-960-1154. It's the number to the planning department for the city of Jackson for the Neighbors First program. This is another way to build an economic base,
mm-hmm.
specifically for the people who live in the neighborhood, not folks who don't live in the neighborhood,
mm-hmm.
folks who live in the neighborhood. This is a way where you can make money. This is us using legislation to build an economy.
Right.
Because if you got a house across the street, now you can fix it up, rent it out, and now you got a piece of wealth.
You look at your
right.
Your property.
I'll just leave the money in the bank. Look right. Across the street. Look at it. Look at your money grow.
Right.
Hello, caller. Welcome to the show. You're on the air, caller. Turn your radio down, caller.
My name is Shelly.
Hey, Shelly. How you doing?
I'm doing great. I listen to you guys all the time. I'm I lived with a strange white, and I'm a female. And I have a lot of opinions to offer.
Okay, what you got, Shelly?
Well, you know, this racism thing is just being socially engineered by the powers that be to break us all up, right? And I live in a mostly black community, and a mostly black, mostly black city. I'm zero racist. Okay,
I know, Shelly. I'm from nothing down that way, too. You know, I live on Lee Avenue. Well, I used to live on Lee Avenue.
Yeah. But I feel like, you know, I don't feel like I'm the majority. And only because I don't buy into the social engineering that's going on to make us hate each other.
That's right.
Because really, when it comes down to it, the only way that, the only thing that would bring the system to a halt, and it would change for everybody, would be if we all united.
That's right.
So they break us down on these different levels and everything. I'm listening to you guys all the time. I'm totally vested in the black community, but let me tell you how. Because I see that if the black community was to, and I live in it, so, you know, if the black community was to build some businesses, right? Have its own communities, break free from the government. No, you know, get off the welfare. Like, that would be the last thing you want to do, unless you absolutely had to, was to be dependent on this system. So this system works against everybody, just in different ways. And it definitely, like, the social engineering on in the black communities with the hip hop, the liquor on the liquor store on every corner, they just keep everybody down, but they also make it seem like it's the white people, just the general white population that would be the enemy to the black people. It's not. It's the white elite people.
Right. That's right. Are you right?
Because I'm not getting a damn check for being white or any benefits from being white whatsoever. They are. Mm-hmm. They're using these different things they do in black community, and it makes me sick. It makes me sick. What really makes me sick is how people are falling for this race thing. Like, we were going up. Like, you remember, I was like, I voted for Obama twice. And I thought, that's the end of that, you know? Before Obama became president, we were talking, we were getting there, we were doing our thing. Things were kind of becoming a little bit peaceful, a little more, you know, whatever. But now, man, I'm talking 6 years into it, it's almost like a fundamental race war. You know, or you would think with the way that the media talks about it. And they're engineering us still that way. I wanted to do like this, get together with like community or whatever, and have black folks and white folks talk about it. But you know what? White folks have been programmed to fear the black community, and black folks have been programmed to think that the white community is holding them down in some way. You understand what I mean?
Oh, you're speaking outside. I'm going to be overjoyed.
We'll give you a volunteer sheet.
I'm not the only one, because I go on social media. I'm not the only one that felt this way. I just would encourage the black community to understand that they're being engineered the same way white people are, just on a different level. White people are engineered to work till they're 72, to pay their taxes to the rest of the world, to become in debt, so that they're a slave to the system. They're the hamster in the wheel that keeps it turning, right? And then all they have to do is just fear all the minorities that might be trying to take their spots. They got it so good, right?
Right.
They don't have time to think about whether if they got it so good. We're basically, in America right now, we're fighting just to live in crap. Basically crap, you know? Like, none of us have it good. We're all broke now.
That's right.
We're really all the same level. We just have been engineered to think we aren't.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? It's absolutely crazy. And when I turned on the radio today, was driving in Jackson, I was just like, man, because I've been wanting to call for so long.
Hey, call every week.
Man,
every Wednesday at 6.
Listen, I hear you. We're all struggling with just going on different levels. It's all manipulation. It's all propaganda. It's all BS.
That's right.
And if we can just break free from that, man, mm-hmm. we are behind from the it's illegal, then you could by working inside the system, then the system is broke.
That's right. Hey, we appreciate you, Sheriff, for calling in. We got 1 minute to go on the show.
You too.
All right, tune in on the internet. Thanks a lot.
All right, bye.
And as we always say, that's proof right there that when the descendants of the slaves and the descendants of the slave owners and the descendants of the overseers realized that they were all enslaved. Mm-hmm. There was at different levels of comfort.
Right.
The overseer wasn't finna get off that horse and put that shotgun down. Mm-hmm. He's at a different level of no more wealth now.
All right.
It's a different level of comfort. So what we all must realize is that we're in this together.
Right.
We got to work together. Mm-hmm. We're not going anywhere. So we got to tear down this system, you know. Both the political parties are broken.
Right.
Republican and Democrat don't reflect the people.
Nobody.
Or the people's interests. Right?
What you gonna do about it?
So what we have to do now is put our interests first, that we're gonna be working together to move this whole state forward. We're gonna drag it forward. Because Mississippi's not gonna move. It's gonna be forced to exist, right? So it's gonna take folks over here reviving Mississippi to help move Mississippi to the direction where it needs to go. So as always, everybody, I love you. Never let anyone put you in a position where you hate your own people. And I'm not just talking about black people, I'm talking about your own people. We're all Mississippians here. Never let anybody put you in a position where you hate your own people, because when you hate, you're part of the very oppression we're trying to lift ourselves out of. I'll see y'all next week. I love y'all. God bless.
All right.